to see. On change.org also in 2018, it was very interesting the shift that happened. Because earlier, you know, we used to get like these petitions on women's rights, and most of them were, you know, reactive petitions. So if there is a case of sexual violence, there will be justice for the survivor. So they were more reactive campaigns. In 2018, we saw something different happen. Most of these reactive campaigns were started by men, and they had this whole narrative around, let's protect our women. We need to protect our women. We need justice for them, and men fighting for the causes of women. In 2018, we saw women sort of taking lead and starting campaigns on issues that mattered to them. And they looked at patriarchy, which is so deeply embedded in the society, not as like this big thing which was there, but they looked at patriarchy and tried to chip away by starting campaigns on smaller issues and attacking them like that. Let me just give you an example, and then I just want to tell like a story of Purnima. Purnima is 40 years old, and she was abused as a child when she was growing up in Chennai. And she didn't even realize for the longest time what had happened to her. She went for studies to Canada, and then she saw a film which talked about good touch, bad touch, and then she realized almost after 25 years what had happened to her as a child. And she wanted to do something about it, right? She went to the police station in Chennai, and she wanted to report this case. And the police said, well, the statute of limitation has passed. This crime occurred way back when. Sorry, you can't report it. So what Purnima did then was she started a online campaign on change.org, and she basically wanted an answer from the government on what the rules of POSCO are, the new law on prevention of making it safer for children. And it was a long battle. Everybody in her family, especially the men, dissuaded her, saying, don't go ahead with this, you're not going to get anywhere. Her campaign got 3.8 lakh signatures. She went and met the Minister of Women and Child Development. And after almost 6 months of going through this process, the Ministry of WCD finally came out and said, POSCO applies irrespective of when the crime was committed, and they removed any statute of limitations from that law. And that happened because of this one person's determination on like not letting what happened to her just stay. You know, she wanted to bring about change. So I would like to believe that change has happened. The Supreme Court and the amazing cases that we saw, and the landmark judgments that happened, but also like individual, just regular, everyday men and women looking at an issue and saying, let's do something about it.
Oh, that's fantastic. Yeah, I think that's a very optimistic note to start on. I'm going to come to Noorjehan next, and I think Noorjehan, you might not be that optimistic, because the Supreme Court came up with the triple talaq verdict, but after that there was a Muslim Woman Marriages Act which came up in Parliament, and I think the Lok Sabha, in fact, which was a BJP that government, passed it. But in the Rajya Sabha, where the current government is in a minority, unfortunately it did not get passed. So do you really think for a Muslim woman, 2019, after that judgment, India is a better place to live in?
No, I'm still optimistic, because the struggle which was started by women like Shah Bano in 1985 and Mumtaz, and then Shaira Bano took it up 2016. She was the one who filed the petition, and then four other women filed the petition, and then my organization, Bharatiya Muslim Mahila Andolan, we pitched into that petition. Yes, setback, yes. The Supreme Court judgment is welcome. This is the second judgment which has come against triple talaq. The fact that the bill was able to go into the Lok Sabha for the first time ever,
right,
and the demand came from nobody else but ordinary Muslim women, and it got passed in the Lok Sabha twice, that itself is an achievement. Yes, we have still a long way to go. Rajya Sabha is still to be conquered, and now with the new government, the struggle starts all over again. But I'm still optimistic that we've been able to bring the debate out in the open. So while the issue was not allowed to be discussed, no, these are matters of Sharia, these are matters of religion, nobody should be talking about it, women should to never be talking about it at all, never mind if they are victims. And so from there, we've come to a stage where the bill has got right up to the Lok Sabha. So absolutely optimistic and the struggle goes on.
Just go back and think, have you ever been attracted towards anyone of the same gender? Be a teacher in your school or college or a fellow student. Have you ever been attracted? Just, you like that person. Yeah, can I have show of your hands? So just imagine if that likeness happened to be, or actually you realized after some time that you actually started loving that person. So if you can imagine a situation where you actually went up to that person and said that I really like you, I really love you, and this person is of the same gender, so if it's a woman to woman or a man to man, and they said, I really admire you, I really like you, I'm sexually attracted towards you, and the moment you shared this, that person actually kind of ridiculed you and said you are really deviant and never come and speak to me. When you shared your feelings to your mother, mother actually started crying, saying that how can I conceive you, and it's a raw, so you are not the person which I wanted. Father said there must be a genetic default or in our genes. Your siblings start saying that disassociating yourself because you are not normal. And then in school, school authorities actually don't want you to be in the school because probably attraction towards same gender is kind of infection, which is contagious, and they don't want you in school. Similarly in colleges and in morally correct companies and corporates, they don't want you because it will have a negative connotation to all the customers are coming, that you have this kind of person in your company. And to correct all that, what remedy which most of the families and society used to prescribe was to get a treatment, a hormonal treatment, to turn you from a homosexual orientation to a heterosexual orientation, and then get married to a heterosexual or a person from the opposite gender, and that will sort everything out. And I think last year was a landmark judgment where everything was tossed, and now homosexual community is being recognized. Though they are in minority, yes, they are only 10% of the population, but they are there, and it's not abnormality, and it's as normal as being a left-hander and a right-hander, and being in a minority is not a sin. And I think Section 377, after Deepak Mishra's judgment, the long judgment, I think they have accepted and appreciated that they exist, and accepted that there was a flaw in the law, and they can't be criminalized because of their sexual orientation. It's much more, it's as natural as heterosexuality, and I think that has given a lot of relaxation, relief to the community, and gradually I think everybody will come out and be as normal as anyone else. So I think it was a great year of change.
Fantastic, thank you.
I think 2018 has been the year of the woman. I mean, the Me Too movement was like one of the biggest global movements which has happened in recent times. And not that sexual harassment or sexual violence didn't happen before this year. You know, it's been happening for years together, and 20 years, 30 years, 50 years. And I think it is not a really elitist kind of a concept, because even in India, if you look, Bhavri Devi case, which happened like years ago, she was one of the first women who was gang raped because she took an action of preventing child marriage in her community. So stories of resilience, of women stepping out, being bold, you know, fighting cases, standing with each other, networking, and being bold about their own, has been in the country for a very, very long time. Me Too kind of what was like really empowering in the sense, because women felt that they were not alone, and it really brought them together, and then they felt that this was not just my own personal struggle, it is the struggle of a majority of women. If you look at the statistics, almost 38% of the women face sexual violence, sexual harassment at workplace within the first year of working. and almost 70% of women face sexual harassment at workplace in their entire lifetime. So that's the kind of scale of violence that we are talking about, and this movement just brought everyone together, and I think the social media was very, very effectively used to harness the thing. But it did not only remain within the social media. That's something which I want to highlight. Even yesterday there was this very big march which happened across 20 cities in India, where women came out, people with transgender orientation came out, people for LGBT rights came out, and they stood for their rights, for constitutional rights, for fighting against patriarchy, for fighting against violence. So it was really, you know, reinforcing that Me Too wasn't just a spark and it didn't die off there, because women are really taking over the spaces. They're really wanting to own the space, and they're asserting themselves online, offline, in villages, in factories, in corporates, in political spaces. I think the time has come and we need to just take over.
I'm scared now. I should run off here, yeah, with four women sitting beside me saying take over.
Take over, but with inclusion. Inclusion is like, it's never us versus them, Nipun. I think when you're talking about women's rights, it's not as if we are anti-men.
Or we are anti-other.
There is no concept of us versus them. When we think about an inclusive society, it is about taking everyone together, bringing everyone to speed, where everyone has equal opportunities regardless of their sex, caste, creed, class, gender, sexual orientation. And I think that's what is important.